Les objectifs de développement durable permettent-ils de concilier développement économique?
Do sustainable development goals allow us to reconcile economic development, social well-being and protection of the environment? This question has kept political and scientific circles on their toes for decades. When the sustainable development goals were adopted in 2015, several modern time challenges started to converge, such as urban and industrial development, accentuation of inequalities, climate change and biodiversity erosion, urging us to redefine the framework in which development happens. The fact that these issues are closely intertwined has brought all walks of society, from the individual to the international community, to increased awareness, improved knowledge, integration, and greater consistency in both public and private policies. In this video, we will discuss SDG internal dynamics and the interdependence between the various goals. How to integrate the three dimensions of sustainable development is not an issue, but one the significance of which is increasing. This graph illustrates what many refer to as the great acceleration, meaning that everything in red refers to the socio-economic development intensification, which started in 1950, accelerating the growth of the global population, of fertilizers and energy consumption, as well as of the infrastructure development. On the right-hand side, we find similar trends with regard to natural resources consumption and biophysical processes, accompanied by an increase in land conversion, fish resources consumption, and methane and carbon dioxide emissions, everything clearly picking up speed as of 1950. The impact that human activities have on the environment acquires a global dimension, and the growing interactions between man and his environment raise the question of how to achieve a balance between the three dimensions of sustainable development again. SDGs have feasted on countless analyses, which all have in common that they steer economic development towards promotion of social well-being without compromising the integrity of the biosphere and that of natural processes, which serve as foundation for life and human development. Today, SDGs are made of 17 goals, 169 targets, 230 follow-up indicators, in the framework of a compromise obtained after several years of international negotiations. The 2030 agenda explicitly acknowledges that the dimensions of sustainable development were included in the definition of some of the goals and targets. It is often presented as an indivisible whole. Now, the notions of indivisibility and universality suggest that the world of SDG is based on win-win synergy and strategies. Well, no, it does not go without saying. Do SDGs form a consistent package? How are governments and players approaching their implementation? How to steer clear of millennium goals for which progress has, in many cases, for instance, reducing extreme poverty, gone hand in hand with the growing use of fossil fuels? And finally, how can the orchestra of the countless players needed to implement the SDGs be directed? To address those questions, we need to connect SDGs among them so that each SDG is put into perspectives with the others, and we also need to look into the interfaces. The International Science Council and the Stockholm Environment Institute have developed a system to define the level of influence one policy may have on another, just like one goal may have an influence on another. It comprises of seven levels, which empirically describe the level of influence of one goal on another, and in a way, it's all about going further than a mere description of the interactions between SDGs, be they positive, negative, or both. With regard to synergies, the first level is that for which pursuing an objective creates favorable conditions for the fulfillment of another goal. For instance, electrifying rural areas pursues the objective of ensuring education for all, because it allows children to do their homework at night with light. We're talking indirect effect. The second level is that of reinforcement. Fulfilling of goal A contributes to fulfilling goal B. Here we have a direct and necessary contribution. For instance, developing non-carbonated energies allows to decrease air pollution, thus directly contributing to improved health in the population. Finally, the highest level of interdependence is reached when an objective cannot be met without another one being fulfilled. Take, for instance, promoting gender equality in public life. It goes hand in hand with eradicating all forms of discrimination against women. Likewise, fulfilling two goals may cause tensions or even contradictory effects. Sometimes pursuing one objective may generate limitations or conditions to the fulfillment of another. For example, actions taken to protect natural resources may impose a limitation on economic resources which are directly dependent on the use of said resources. It could be, for instance, fishing quotas. Two objectives may be conflicting. For instance, ensuring access to a sufficient quantity and quality of food may be countering the objective that consists in limiting water takeout and the use of chemicals. Lastly, progressing towards an objective may render it impossible to reach another. For instance, developing infrastructures may cancel all efforts made to preserve the ecosystems in the area involved. By applying this analysis template to all targets and goals, we highlight the goals with the greatest influence. And these nodal points in the vast network constituted by connections between SDGs serve as anchorage to define sectorial national objectives and setting priorities among actions and resources. However, this process is not sufficient. The template suggested is useful to establish an initial diagnosis, to update potential synergies, and to anticipate conflicts. However, the nature of a relationship between two goals is not laid out in an absolute way. It depends on the geographical and social-cultural context, the means or even the technologies which may be employed, or the governance systems which could cause disparities between groups, or some of the latter being marginalized. The effects can be postponed in time. Not all SDGs operate on the same timeline. Some have an immediate impact, others take longer to show an effect, such as transport infrastructures, which show a certain degree of inertia and will later shape users or urban areas in a lasting way. Eventually, some effects are not linear and can only be perceived in time, with possible rebound effects. In a nutshell, dismantling SDGs, yes, but why? First of all, it is a matter of awareness and pedagogy. Not all relationships between SDGs are known the same way. For instance, we know the effect access to water and sanitation can have on health, but others are less well known, such as the impact energy transition and new technologies may have on employment, or the impact of biodiversity and ecosystems on social cohesion and inclusion. If we want those relationships to be taken in consideration when making decisions, they must be rendered explicit so that setting priorities does not mean finding an obstacle or being driven back. Secondly, there is a challenge of ensuring that we buy into all the SDGs. We need to go beyond purely sectorial approaches in order for the 2030 agenda to become a common roadmap. Thus, the healthcare policy will no longer be the business only for the Ministry of Health, but also for the Ministry of Public Education, Spatial Planning and Protection of the Environment. By identifying these joint benefits and tensions, we will be able to target which partnerships must be implemented and define who are the winners and who are the losers. The exchange and deliberation process between experts and non-experts about relevant targets and the relationship between objectives and policies generate a shared vision on the action levers. There is also the challenge of consistency and ambition. Our initial analysis showed that there are scores of potential synergies between SDGs. All we need to do is to map impossible routes and review ambition and the scope of existing policies. For those interested, the report is available on the International Science Council website.
Le rapport est disponible sur le site du Conseil international pour la science.